so today's teaching, I called it Abide for Battle. And we abide, of course, there's a lot in like the book of John where when he's talking to the disciples at the Last Supper, and he's talking about abide in me and all that, right? Well, we abide by drawing near, right? We draw near to him. There's a whole lot of discussion, especially with the temple and different things, where you would draw near to God. And the more you drew near to God, the more was required of you, and there was a holiness factor, right? Even the high priest, for example, couldn't defile himself and go to certain funerals, only for certain immediate family members and stuff, depending on the priesthood, where you were. So the closer you draw, the more is required of you in setting yourself apart to God in holiness, because you're drawing near to a very holy, set-apart God. And so we learn some stuff about this, but I feel like sometimes we get bogged down in the abide part and the walk part, and we've neglected the power part. Or you try to get the power, but you're so loosey-goosey that you got no feet on the ground for being holy and set apart. And so you become, even God will work through someone because he honors his word. But when that person all of a sudden was having a little secret affair over here, and now the whole thing looks just, God's name is just drugged through the mud, right? But maybe that person that the miracle worked through because he honored the word. The person got maybe healed or whatever through that person's ministry, but now their character, it was a problem. So this abide for battle, because I feel like, this is like round one was last year. I feel like, hello, birth pain number one. You know, stand by for the next wave, right? And prepare. And that's what I feel like we are getting ready. We're getting prepared for, the next attack. And in battle, that's what we have, right? So you abide by drawing near, but the walk by which we draw near is not the war. So the walk is different from the war. Okay, so we got to just understand that. I'm not going to get into the discussion of looking at, So drawing near, that discussion, we can look at some of these texts here, John 2:28, 14, 17, 15, 4 through 10, where he's really talking about a lot of the abide things. And what we get from that without going through all those is letting his word abide in you and keeping the commandments. That's basically how you abide. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments, yada, yada. Okay, right? We get that. That's the abide. That should be your everyday walk, should be learning to abide, learning to go before him, learning to draw near. And how do you start to do that? You start to order your life according to his commandments. Not very hard, simple, right? Okay, not easy. Simple, not easy. Yeah. Simple to understand, not easy to walk out. But we know that, right? So, but what about the war part? Because that's different. And we're going to go, so turn with me to 2 Corinthians 10:3. I'm going to actually put it up. I put it up for you guys that if you have trouble seeing and or didn't bring a Bible or whatever. So Michaela told me I needed to do that for the younger generation, apparently. Apparently they aren't like us where I like to touch my Bible. I like to like feel and interact with it. But the younger generation, not so much. They're electronic generation. They're digital everything. That's their world. So we will accommodate. All right, so going to 2 Corinthians. Actually, I got to get there myself. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 and 4. And it says, For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but the power that Greek term there is dunamis. And I'm translating this. I don't know if I put that one up. Yeah, I did. But the power is in God. So it's literally, the way that they translate, if you look at some other translations, you might see it different, but it's literally the word power, the power in God, the strength in God, literally. That is where we war. His power, strength, and authority. That's where the battle is. The other part is the abiding. It prepares you for battle. It sets you apart for battle. But the battle is actually operating in the power and authority. Do you see it's a nuance? But we focus a lot on trying to battle with the abide and make everybody abide as if that's the battle. That's not the battle. The battle should have been won there. If your heart is transformed, you're setting yourself apart. You're drawing ever near. You're getting more and more set apart, right? If you're set apart and you've got a transformed heart. So the war is actually learning what we're all trying to grow in here is how to operate in his power and authority that you now stand. Part one is just recognizing that you have power and authority, and then learning how do we engage it? How do we operate in it? So I'm not just getting my rear kicked by the devil all the time because I either don't recognize he's doing something or I don't see that that's an attack, because a lot of people are just totally ignorant of that whole realm, so they just don't even know they're getting attacked, right? Or you're stumbling over just like traumas and other things, you just can't get yourself going, and or you're focused on the world. What were all the things with the parables, right? The different ways that you could get distracted by the cares of the world, or, you know, whatever. You kind of have this in the more affluent areas. Remember, it's harder to come into the kingdom of God when you're wealthy because you're comfortable. You have all your needs met. I don't need God. I'm not desperate for God, right? It's much harder when you have all your needs met to stay desperate and to set yourself apart because you don't necessarily need, quote, him if all of your physical needs are met and you can just go party all the time and just relax and kick back and think, oh, I'm just waiting for that, you know, that virtual exit before the real tribulation thing with all the, you know, certain kind of not correct end time theologies that think you're just going to get out of here and it's going to be just like cakewalk and you'll launch it in the cheap seats. Yeah, no. That's not happening. Sorry. Hate to burst anybody's bubble on that. All right. So what does Paul actually mean here then in this context? Let's look at, first, we had to abide via our walk and align with the truth, we said. But the battle, as we said, that war is by the Spirit in a move of power. Now, in the context of this verse, what was Paul talking about? He was talking about in this particular verse how his ministry, there were slanderers who were saying that he was very bold and confident, almost arrogant or aggressive in his letters. But when they met him, he was kind of meek. He was like, he had authority and power. He walked with great anointing and power. But he wasn't this like aggressive like he sounded in his letters. And so they were giving him a hard time about that. That's sort of the context that we're looking at here. But, so, you know, what's going on? And I'm giving you now the Greek, okay? So if I break it down, if you look right under where it says 2 Corinthians there, right below that, that's the first word, because the actual, there's a in the flesh phrase that comes first in the order of the Greek. So you start there and you say for, and I add the little for English while, and that's not there, but it's just while we walk or we live. While we walk or we live, right? And then you go up and put in the flesh for English grammar, okay? And then go all the way down to the last word is the verb. We ourselves wage war or we fight. We ourselves wage war or fight. And then you go back up to the not according to the flesh. Okay, so that's me breaking it down word for word for you there, just so you can see that. Now, the flesh, of course, is in this context, because sometimes the flesh is our sin nature. That's kind of what he's talking about, right? Here, the flesh is just natural, right? Because what did it say? For though we walk in the flesh, we walk in the natural order. Every day when we read the Word of God, we apply the Word of God. It's natural. I'm to do this on this day or this season or this year. I'm not to do this. I'm to do that. This is all natural order of life. This is how we order our life, and it's very natural, flesh-oriented. It's in the flesh, right? We do it in the mind and the will and the emotion, and we walk about in the natural. However, that, notice, it says we walk in the flesh, meaning we don't walk in the sin nature. I mean, we kind of do, but that's not the context here. In other words, the context here is being used, we walk in the natural. Even though we're in bodies of death and we walk and we're in the natural world, we don't war there. So that is our path we're walking in the natural. We walk a path in the natural, we set ourselves apart according to commandments, but we war in the spirit. So that's what we'll say, okay, well, how do we do that? Right? Because we don't war against flesh and blood. So let's pop over to Ephesians 6:12. It says, for our struggle, and that could also be fight, or literally wrestling. Our struggle, our fight, or wrestle, is not against, or you could say with, flesh and blood. Okay, so that's, we all know that, right? But against what? Let's break these down. Against rulers. Now, in Romans 8:38, they translate the same term as principalities. Against the authorities, and that's exousia. Now, some of your translations will say power there. I hate it when I try to keep consistency in the English for clarity purposes. When it's exousia, I put, in this case, exousias, authorities. I use the word authority for this term, exousia, and I keep consistency with power with the dunamis, because it sounds like dynamite almost. We get the word, so power versus authority, and they kind of tend to mix them all up, but I feel like there's more of a consistency to use power there, so I switch this to authority, just because it's that exousia, not dunamis, okay? And then against the world rulers of this, and they'll sometimes put in present, even though it's not there, it kind of has the sense of the present age darkness, right? This present darkness or present age darkness, this darkness. Against the, now I translate this more literally, spirits of wickedness in the heavenly. Sometimes I'll say spiritual forces of wickedness or other kind of ways of saying that. Spirits of wickedness in the heavenlies. Now they say heavenly places, but it's literally in the plural, so I like to translate this heavenlies, because there's more than one, so we've got kind of the demonic realm level, right? And then you have the place, the third heaven that Paul talks about, where we're seated with Christ, right? So I just translate that the heavenlies, because it is in the plural there. Right? So realize then, if we flip back here, because we know there's the armor we put on, right? We don't wrestle with flesh and blood. Go back a couple pages to Ephesians 2. And here, he's talking, we're going to read through Ephesians 2 here real quick, so I don't have it all up there. So you'll need it either on your phone, or you'll have to follow along in a Bible. If you don't have your Bible, then a phone Bible will work. It says, and you were dead. You were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked or lived. Same term we're looking at here, walked or lived. Because we don't walk, remember, according to the natural man. In this, we formerly walked in the natural in our sins and trespasses. And that, in this sense, it would have more of a sense of you used to walk in the sin nature before when you were dead in your sins, right? You did walk in that way. And why are you doing that? Because you're lawless. Versus now when you're in, you're not lawless anymore. You're under the authority of Messiah. So in which you formerly walked or lived according to the, and I kind of didn't really love the translation in this one. So it's basically the present age of this world. According to the prince of the power of the air. That prince word there could be ruler of the power of the air or prince. And then it says, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. So wait a minute. There's this, the age of this world, which in verse 3 we'll read is the lusts and desires of the flesh and the mind. So that's when you were dead. So a lot of people are walking around the walking dead. If you're not in the Messiah and you're still in your sins and trespasses, you are literally the walking dead. You were dead, Paul says. And so you're dead if you're not. And what that means in verse 3 was the lusts and desires of the flesh and of the mind. Right? And so then he says that when you were dead, that controlled you, your flesh and your mind, lusts and desires. So desires in your mind and your flesh. Notice how he had both. And according to, so it was not just according to that. It was according to this prince or ruler, the authority of the air. That's supernatural. That is not natural. So we are still in supernatural. That's supernatural, right? And which is the and he says that that authority of the air, that prince or that ruler of the authority of the air, is really a wicked, wicked spirit. We know it's a spirit, but because of the context, we're going to know it's a wicked spirit, now working in the sons of disobedience. So sons of obedience would be sons of God. Sons of disobedience would be according to following this prince of the power of the air, or the authority of the air. I did put authority because power, again, the difference between dunamis and exousias. So I will try to have consistency there. So I, a lot of times, do that. It just makes it clearer in our mind, because if you think of a police officer, his badge is his authority. He has authority to execute his office. But his gun is his power, right? If he has to use it. So I try to give us consistency so you can see behind there and go, okay, that's that term. And then you'll understand the context better, because it'll be used in that, usually that way. But when they don't do that in English, then it gets all muddied up, right? So it helps to get that consistency. Now, therefore, you, then he says, have been reconciled, becoming living temples. So we'll go on and keep reading. He says, but in verse, did we get through 3, Jenny? I don't remember if I did. Did I say? Mm-mm. Okay, I'll just read it again. So, verse 3, among them too, we too, all, and here the we is Jews. Notice the context. He said, we too, meaning Jews all, formerly lived in the lusts of our flesh. You mean that guy following the Torah and everything, he lived in that, like those religious people? Guess what? Religious people can live in the lust of the flesh, apparently, right? We have that today. We have a lot of that, right? Indulging the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. The rest of what? Humanity. So he's saying, Paul's saying, we Jews, we did that too. We were just as dead in our sins and trespasses. But God, there's always the but God, right? I love the but God. Being rich in mercy because of his great love, which with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our transgressions, made us alive together with Messiah, by grace you've been saved, and raised us up. So made alive, raised us up with him, that's two, seated us with him, that is Messiah, in the heavenlies. That would be the same thing there again, heavenlies. You can do heavenly places, but heavenlies is more literal. In Messiah Yeshua, or Jesus Christ Jesus, so that in the age to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Messiah Yeshua. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God. What is the grace that you've been saved, right? So, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Obviously, then, it's not about our walking on the path. It's about his workmanship, his empowering us to walk on the path, but his work that he did on the cross. That's why we can't boast. That's why it's not about us being perfect. That's why the power thing, and why so many religious people walk right by and don't care about the broken and the hurting and those getting led into hell, straight, on a fast track, drugs, all kinds of stuff, right? And yet, this is where we're failing as a church, because we're not operating the power and authority, because we don't know, because we're just fat and happy, and we think we're all self-righteous, because we know the truth, and we're just, right? But we're really not warring, right? So let's see, I am in verse 10. For we are his workmanship, created in Messiah Yeshua for good works. So we were created to do good works, but those good works are going to include not just being obedient to the word of God, but operating in power and authority, actually rescuing people from the pit of hell that they're in, because they're dead. They're the walking dead, and they don't know it, and they don't know how to get out of it. And many of them, as we said, are under the control of these spirits, right? This spirit of the ruler of the air, or the, what did it say, the ruler, yeah, authority of the air, so the prince, and obviously under him has the little minions, right? And so that spirit working in the sons of disobedience. And so as we continue, he says, We are created for those good works which God prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. Therefore, remember that formerly you, the Gentiles in the flesh, who were called uncircumcision by the so-called circumcision, which is performed in the flesh by human hands, remember that you were at that time, meaning before you were saved, before you came to know Yeshua, Jesus, at that time, separate from Messiah, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants, notice the plural, covenants of promise, not just the new covenant, it's covenants of promise, Abrahamic, all of them, every single one of them apply to you too. Because, why? They're the covenants of promise. Okay, having no hope and without God in the world. So you were up a creek without a paddle at all, and you had no access to the truth, therefore you had no grace. Hardly. You had general, I guess the theological term, you know, this kind of general, the heavens declare the glory of God. But you had no specific revelation. So having specific revelation, the word of God allows you to have a measure of grace because you at least access the truth. So a Jew had more blessing in that sense because they had at least the knowledge of truth. But they couldn't walk in it from the heart. Remember, he just said over here, yeah, we were the same. We were really up a creek without a paddle. We had grace, but we were stuck in our lust of the flesh, the desire of the flesh, the mind, and the mind. And so he goes on, he says, let's see, I am in verse 13, right? Mm-hmm.
Yep.
But now in Messiah Yeshua, you who formerly were far off have been brought near. Remember, we abide, we get brought near. By, of course, what? The blood of Christ, Messiah. So you're brought near by a higher, more purifying blood, because why? We need access to what realm? For the power and authority that we need. We're seated with Christ, he said, in heavenly places, right? So you had to have access to that throne room to have the authority to call on and then have authority over principalities and, well, the princes, they're the spirits they're talking about, right? That, by which we cast out devils, right? So you sit with, you're seated with Christ, well, that gives you what? Heavenly authority. We can bind and loose on earth as it is in heaven, right? We can have that authority, right? So we had to access that. How do you access? What was the, there was a change in law. It wasn't a change from something here to a new thing that you dump that. No, it was, if I'm on earth and I'm trying to enter the earthly temple, this is the requirement. It actually should be translated requirement if they were consistent, but they're not. They use requirement, they use that English word, and then they switch it because they want to make you presuppose it has different meaning in a certain area that, oh, it's a new law, get rid of God's old law. Why? Because, you know, now it's okay to just throw out, you know, this law and that law, and why you have a lot of perversion in the church right now. And it's just okay to accept it. Why? Because they think, oh, well, you don't need that old thing, spirit of lawlessness convinces them of that. Right? Just, oh, you don't need to do that anymore. That's not for you. You just have the new covenant. All that other stuff, those other covenants don't apply. No, they don't worry about those. Don't worry about that. You know, hello, your path is just like, I don't know. I mean, you can glean 3/4 of it by the New Testament because it's, a lot of it is repeated. But where do you think it came from? You know, like there was a standard, you know, right? So anyway, you know, they get into this. So I'm at, let's see, 13. But now in Messiah Yeshua, so you are far off, you're brought near by the blood of Christ, for he himself. Okay, look at this transition. And a lot, this is something I'm going to do one of the papers for SBL or ETS again, because it's not normally understood in this way, but it is so powerful. Because we always put our eyes on us. This is the problem with a lot of the translation I've noticed, is we're so us focused that we miss things. So it goes from saying you who were far off have been brought near. That means the nations have now been brought near, because it wasn't just Israel, right? So now the nations too have been brought near, the Gentiles, by the blood of Christ. He says, for he himself is our peace. He himself, and it's that it has that double emphatic, like he himself is our peace, who made both, and this is in the neuter, it'll just not important, but it is important in the grammar, both being God and man, not Jew and Gentile yet. He himself who brought near the Gentile, he did what? By his own blood, he himself. What about he himself, that is our peace, that made both one, both what? God and man, right? God and man in the person. This is why the incarnation was like mind blow. We take it for granted. But at that time, it was like, wait, what? He's God in the flesh. How does that work? And everyone's like, I have no idea. I'm watching him do all this stuff, though. So it is what it is. Deal with it. And we had this whole long debates for years and centuries trying to figure out, how do we even articulate that? Right? And we finally came up with this word Trinity and so on and so forth through the centuries, right? But the incarnation, they were experiential Trinitarians. They just experienced it before they articulated it and understood it. They were just like, I don't know what to tell you, Holy Spirit is just like, it is what, he's God in the flesh. What do you do with that? How do you express that? Right? And so he himself, that incarnation, think about it, was God and man at rest in a man, in a person. Again, we had Adam and that was lost. And now we have Yeshua, Jesus born, and the Spirit of God is at rest in a man perfectly. And then it gets reconciled. But it's he himself is literally the going back to get the bringing together in a person. Like it's a mind blow. He made both God and man one in the person of Messiah Yeshua Jesus, having, and that should be really a participle, having broken down the barrier of the dividing wall, which was what? Sin. Hello. God and man separate because of sin. God cannot be in a man. So that's why I was like, wait, God is in this man right here, and then he had to sew it, right? And then he he came to and preached peace to you who were far away. That would be the nations, right, who are far away from God, didn't have access, and peace to those who are near. That would be at that point called the Jews, but Israel, who was who had drawn near to God through the temple, but didn't still had the same death problem for the access to the world to come. For through him we both have our access in one spirit to the Father. For then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints, that is holy ones, and are of God's household, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Messiah Yeshua himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole building is being fitted together, is growing into a holy temple in the Lord. In whom you, nations, also are being built together into a dwelling of God in the Spirit. So if we understand that we're literally a house, we are like a house. And spirit, there's our spirit, and then other spirits and or the Holy Spirit. There's only two options. technically, you can have the Holy Spirit in the inner man, and you can open the door to devils in your life and give them your authority and dominion and access. I mean, you can do that. You can do really stupid things and get yourself, go do witchcraft and, people have done horrible things as believers, and God rescues them and has mercy on them and they come back, but you can't habitually sin and think that he's not going to say, get away from me, you worker of lawlessness. Torahlessness, lawlessness. Like, why would we get rid of the standard, right? This is where we end up. But we're not like, his burden is not this heavy burden that they put down. It's not a religious heavy burden. It's just words of life. And then you can't just like read it and be like, I'm just gonna follow it all and I'm gonna be perfect either. Doesn't work that way. Good luck with that. Ha ha. You're probably not gonna get through one 24-hour period, in which case you would probably, especially in our culture and age, you're gonna like perfectly follow this thing perfectly and just like get to the end of your day and like, well, great, you get a congratulations, but really not the point. Because at the end of the day, the point is the war. The point is the battle we're in, right? This is what kind of I'm saying with regard to we walk in the flesh, meaning in the natural. In this context, it's using it of the natural, right? We said, so we do walk in the natural, meaning we do read the Bible, we try to obey the commandments, we try to walk righteously, we try to set ourselves apart, and we're ever increasing in our knowledge of that and trying to do a better job and trying to reflect the Master more and be more holy, because, you know, you'll get a conviction. The more you draw near, the less your music list is going to be, pretty much. Stuff like that. Like, all of a sudden, you're like, yeah, I can't listen to that. It bothers me. Because you grieve the Holy Spirit. So the more you get closer to God, the more is required of you. Just like we saw in the natural temple, the closer those that ministered, more was required, right? And the more authority and power we operate in, more is going to be required of us. We're not going to just be able to be like, oh, I can just go watch that questionable movie. All of a sudden you're like grabbing the thing, oh my God, like, you know, all of a sudden a random porn scene comes up and you're like, seriously, why do they do that? You need, like, I really want the, there's like one of those programs that has, where they can filter all that stuff, but it's horrid, you know, like you can't, you just gotta watch yourself more. You can't do that because you'll grieve the Holy Spirit, and then you just can't, more is required. So it's not a matter of like, oh, you're horrible because you watch this, or you're at this level and I'm at this level, and it's not about that. But it is about, if we want to operate in power and authority, we're going to have to be set apart more. We're going to have to be more sensitive to the Holy Spirit. You don't want to grieve him and you don't want to quench him. I got both, I remembered five. I usually forget one. So that's going to be a requirement, but it's not... We're not to run around, and this is why I felt this verse was so powerful, because we end up wanting to make the drawing near as if that's the battle. And in our flesh, yeah, when we battle our flesh a little bit, there is a battle there, obviously. You know, nobody wants to do some of those things. Our flesh does not want to volunteer to be holy. I'm sorry, it just doesn't. It never will. But our spirit is willing. Remember, the flesh is weak, right? But that's really not the battle he's talking about here, where we are actually rescuing people from death. And what is the real mission? What is the commander's intent? His intent in the commission is for us to rescue people from the pit of hell, that they are literally walking dead. And when you watch, there's this one guy that I've been watching, his name is Dustin, Street Ministry 7 is his. He just has a YouTube and he just videos. He just goes out and he's like in like very poor, very people that are like on drugs and like really bad off. And he walks up and watching the power of God move on with him, I'm just like, wow, I'm jealous. Like, you have the righteous, like holy jealousy of like, oh, I want to get there. You know, like, oh, to see people just go 180. In like minutes, because the Holy Spirit comes and just bam, and the devils fly out, and all of a sudden they're just like, oh my gosh, I'm free. I feel it. Like, you just see the power move. Now, of course, now they need discipling and stuff. Well, obviously, they've just been on drugs in the street usually, and all kinds of other crazy stuff, you know, witchcraft, crazy stuff. But that encounter that they have is undeniable. I mean, some of the stuff is just so funny. You watch some of the videos, and they had this one guy. They were at the grocery store, and the dude was literally laid out like right here in the middle of the. It was kind of off the aisle, like by the. I think it was kind of where they had some like meat things or whatever, like one of those freezers. He was kind of laid out right there, and he was like in a total trance. Like, he was out. He was like. And so they're kind of even giggling, because it does look kind of funny, because sometimes people just kind of go down, and then they help them back up, you know, or they'll go down for a little while, and they're like, oh, it's fine, they're fine, the Spirit of God's on them, you know, it's okay. But this one was just so funny, because it just looked, because he was kind of laying with his arms, were like there, and he was just like, he was in a total trance, like gonzo, for like 5 or 10 minutes, and finally he came back, like two and stuff. But some of them, you know, you just laugh, but he's like, we're bringing church to the marketplace again. And I'm like, kind of think that's where we have to go. And then you've got to bring them back and train them, though. So it's not like we're going to abandon the church building. But I really feel like that's where we need to be heading more as a church, period. And I feel like we're getting that. We're seeing a lot of these ministries like Sean Foyt and them that are going around. They've got the worship gifting, so they're doing those, you know, kind of stirring people up and getting people outside. But he's building this little army, and I'm really trying to get him out. I reached out. I don't know if he'll get the email. I'm sure he's now getting inundated, but he was just in Oklahoma this last week. But if I can connect with him, I'd really like to get him out and have him come take us out. And like, I'm like, man, it won't take us much time to grow. if he trains us, then we do that. Like, man, I mean, people are hungry. People are desperate. People are hungry. They're dying like droves. And so we really have to like push ourselves out of our comfort zone and be like, hey, this is kingdom work. And it's exciting because this is where the battle is, though. But it's interesting theologically as well, because it's not so much about, oh, I'm so good at the roles, or, you know, I'm perfect, or, you know, because you have a tendency to neglect those people, or, oh, that's for the evangelists, or that's for whoever, you know. And it's like, wait a minute. I'm like, once you get, I think, a hold of the power and authority we stand in, and once we start to lay hands on people and start praying and like get, you're going to get addicted. Like, you're going to be like, I just want to sit. I want everybody, like, come on, God, let's just go get the big. I feel like that's what's coming, and I'm like getting so amped up about it, because I'm like, oh my gosh, this harvest is coming. We got to get ready, because then we're going to have to train them. We're going to have to school them. But I'm like, when we can get a hold of this, it's going to break out like insane. And people, like, it's so cute because they have some teenagers that are operating in this, and it's just so cute because they're like teenage boys, right? So they're like playing around, it's like with the Holy Spirit, you know? They're like laying hands on each other to make each other fall down and under like the power, like silly, like little children. And he says, come to me like little children. So it's almost like cute. It's adorable because they're just like, they laugh because then they make each other fall down, right? And it like does that what like young boys would do, you know? So it's cute to see them just like in this innocent, sweet, but then they go with their dad out there and they're laying hands on people that are drug addicts and stuff. They're seeing God move like powerful. So it's not like they're not serious when they need to be serious. But sometimes they were doing it with their cousin on this one video I was watching, because he just can't like, I guess one of their cousins came to know the Lord through them, you know, ministering to him and stuff. And so they were like messing around because the anointing was so strong in that moment when he was like experiencing this, that they kept like, you know, just messing around with each other like that. And I thought, that's cute. That's just fun. Like, and you'd get religious people that would go all off and like, you can't do that. That's not holy enough, you know? And it's like, come on, they're kids. And he says, come to me like children. And if you can go get drunk and make a fool of yourself, why can't we have a little bit of fun with the Holy Spirit, you know? He said, I mean, one of his first miracles was turning water to wine. I mean, come on. But they, like, Holy Spirit, why? Remember they said in Acts 2, it looks like they're drunk. Well, yeah, you know, and sometimes you need some joy because there are some hard things people go through. So if they start giggling and, like, get that joy come on them, you know, sometimes you need a good laugh. It's good medicine for the body, it says in the scripture. So it's like, come on. Sometimes people get too uptight, so it's funny. But anyway, I'm going to wrap this up by just hearkening us back to Matthew 4, where we had talked about the first encounter we had was the temptation of Messiah, right? And so right after that, he goes to Capernaum. I'll just show you some pictures from Capernaum. Have you been showing them? Okay. That was Peter's, go to the next one. That was to the side. So these are like little houses where the in that area of Capernaum by Galilee, Sea of Galilee. And so then, you can go to the next one. Yeah, so that's the synagogue at Capernaum. Go back all the way a little bit more, Michaela. See that bench? Remember when he talks about them wanting the best seats in the house kind of thing? That's what they're talking about. That kind of bench. So like, oh, you want the best seat in the house. You want, you know, like you just want to be honored. And like, so that's at Capernaum. So that's like the seats that they were talking about. Like if you had that seat, you were like, hey, you got the nice seat, right? You know, versus that. So keep going, go back the other way, Michaela. And so if you're going, and this is, so it has kind of two rooms. That's the main room, and then through that, that's the main space, and then keep going. And then you go through the other side. There was like a separate little, like, kind of, must have been an eating maybe space or something, because it was like kind of like more formal room looking and less formal. And then here's Mickey. And then to the behind the synagogue, that was all those like homes kind of behind the synagogue. And then after that, that just covers over where they think, like, supposedly what we read about, like, Peter's mother-in-law's house, I think, or that when the Lord goes in and, like, heals his mother-in-law, remember? So, and keep going. And so that's what's underneath that building. Like, and it, they have, like, kind of a octagonal shape, I guess, or not, yeah, octagonal-shaped one right there. Anyway, it's kind of interesting. And we lost some of the photographs, but I did still have this one of Capernaum, so I just wanted to show you, I thought it would be interesting. And right there, then, is the Sea of Galilee, so it's, like, right there, like, right on the Sea of Galilee. And that's looking to the other, that would be to the east, kind of a little bit east-southeast on that edge. So, interesting. So, anyway, so then we looked at that. So right after he got tempted, he goes and he kind of hides out and he ends up in Capernaum there. And so then we see this verse. It gets a quote, and then it says, "From that time, Jesus or Yeshua began to preach and say, 'Repent,'" and that's of course in a command form. It's an imperative. "Repent, for the kingdom of," and you could say, "the heavenlies is drawn near." So what is he really saying? The power and authority of God has come upon. It's like a come to Jesus moment of the expression, right? A, oh, snap. Like, the power and authority of God has come. Turn, repent, for the kingdom of the heavenlies, meaning that supernatural power has drawn near. So we draw near to God, but now God has drawn near. That power and authority has drawn near. And that's a moment. Because what do people fear when we get into this power and authority and supernatural? They fear the demonic, right? Because sometimes the devils do make people do weird stuff and they get spooked out, or they watch too many movies that, you know, make it like dramatic and everything, which you can. I mean, there's weird stuff that's happened. People do all kinds of crazy stuff sometimes in deliverance. So it's not weird sometimes, but it is a demonstration of the power and authority of God manifest in the earth. And when that happens, there is a, ooh, God is drawn near. Power and authority is going out and it's undeniable. But what does it do and why do we need it? It validates the truth. It validates the word, the gospel that we carry, what we're saying. There's undeniable. And you can see on the gentleman, Dustin, that he's had, you know, a variety of different people with backgrounds, that it's undeniable. You know, Satan worshiping all the way to, you know, Muslim, you name it. Like, and so it's interesting because you can't deny it. You finally are ready to listen. And in this culture, they won't sit like y'all are being patient with me, with like an academic, like, hey, let's dig in the weeds here for a little bit. But they won't listen to that. They're like soundbite believers, right? Little happy, like, just give me a couple ways to have a successful life. Okay, not the reason we're here, right? Yes, he's going to give you a long life. And how do you get a long life? Well, he gave you blessings or cursings. Follow my commandments, you'll get blessed in the present age. Or you don't, and the curse will come up. You put yourself under a curse, it'll come upon you faster, like death, right? Because, you know, gluttony, whatever, you know, pick your pill, you know. So anyway, so that is how it kind of comes down. So we're going to get into it, or we're going to get into it. So the final thing here, just to wrap up, we're going to draw near and get intimate. And there's kind of a double entendre here. So if you don't get intimate, you'll lose the fight because you won't be prepared for the battle, right? So you got to draw near to God and you got to set yourself apart so you're ready to fight. But also at the same time, if you get intimate, right, you will also get into it with the devil. As you get intimate and you draw near, you're going to get into it, right? With the devil. So there's going to be a battle. So we're going to prepare for battle, taking the kingdom by force, overcoming with that superior Holy Spirit firepower, that supernatural authority, the signs, wonders, and everything, as they said, the miracles, that's to confirm the word that we walk by, and not most people's experience, of course. And so with James 4:8, it says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. And then he says, cleanse your hands, you sinners, purify your hearts, you double-minded or you doubters. So we can't doubt, we can't be walking in sin, or we're not going to be able to draw near. But Isaiah 29:13 says, we read about how God's people had drawn near, but only through words and traditions. So we can't just do it through words and traditions, not by the heart, they said in that verse. So we can't do that, and we can't, as Leviticus knows, you couldn't have a defect and draw near in the temple. So like if you had a defect, you couldn't be a priest, you know, it excluded you. What did we learn there though? Like, so we need Messiah, we need to be cleansed. He takes care of our defects, our sin, like, so we can come alive, so we can have that authority, so that we can be righteous, who can operate. So we learn that. Thus, we must be a Messiah first, and we must drink the living water. So streams of living water will flow from our innermost being. Okay, and that's the power. That's where that power is going to come out, and we're going to be able to lay hands on people, and that power and authority actually has the ability to drive out the demonic and to fill them with the new wine and that Holy Spirit, and that will help, you know, free them from literally eternal damnation, like, which is the goal, right? That's the commission. So next week we will do stop and think and start drink, or stop thinking and start drinking. That will be the title. So learn how to stop thinking so much, like us academics, and start drinking that new wine.